Don't say things you might regret. Just one phrase can ruin everything. I know this from my own experience. A few years ago, I was a student. In the early spring, I was returning home after studying in part-time work. It was getting dark. I was on the bus and thoroughly looked at the street. Lights were already coming on in the windows of houses in some places. The bus dragged along in the evening traffic jam, and I lazily looked at other people's rooms, chandeliers, curtains, flowers in the windows. One of the houses stood slightly at the back of the street. Almost all of its windows were dark, but one of them was lighter than the others. I looked closer and realized that the window seemed light because of the silhouette in it, or rather because of the face. It was pale, bleached, white so much that it seemed luminous. I didn't really have time to see this face. I just realized or even felt that something was wrong with him, not right. I even tried to look back, but we had already passed on. The bus pulled up to the stop, opened the doors, and I saw that creepy pale face again. Only now it was in the window of another house. He was standing right behind the bus stop, and I clearly saw that it was a man, and he was looking right at me. Without blinking, with a direct look, he stared at me unkindly, and I couldn't look away. His face, by the way, was normal, except for the pallor. Normal human features, no horror, only the eyes were dark. The bus started moving, the window was left behind, and I gradually calmed down. To avoid looking out the window and not seeing it again, I took out my phone and stared at the screen the rest of the way. Only once did I look up when a man in a bright jacket sat on the seat in front of me. He turned his head to the window, and I shrank into the back of my chair. The skin was parchment white, even glowing. He looked so much like that silhouette in the windows. I squeezed my eyes shut, and when I opened my eyes, I realized that imagination and fear had twisted the image. It was an ordinary, even slightly tanned face. After about 10 minutes, the bus arrived, and I got off at my stop, walked home, and called my boyfriend on the way. We chatted for a while, and he suggested we meet tomorrow. At home, I turned on the lights all over the apartment and started cooking dinner. The thought of the man from the window didn't leave my head. It was completely dark outside the window when the car alarm screeched in the yard. There were problems with the engine, and that's why I had to take public transport for a while. Looking out the window, I found nothing suspicious. It's completely dark, you can't see anything. I had to get closer, lean against the glass to see what happened there. At first, I didn't see anything. But when I looked up, I realized that right in front of me in the window of the opposite house, that pale face appeared again. My legs suddenly weakened. I couldn't move because of the numbing horror, and I couldn't stop looking. I felt my throat constrict as my eyes began to burn from the inside with horror, as tears accumulated in them. I couldn't even scream. The face nodded slightly. "There you are." And I was able to tear myself away from the window. I fell to the floor. I was able to crawl with my back to the opposite wall, staring at my window, and saw that now a face looms right behind it. He looked at me for a few seconds, and then hit the glass outside with a pale palm. I heard the sound of a blow and realized that he was really here. And then I shouted, "Take anything but leave me alone." At the same moment, the creature recoiled from the glass and disappeared into the darkness. I had an unopened bottle of wine. To fall asleep, I had to drink it all. Only that day didn't end there. After midnight, my boyfriend's mother called me. Choking with tears, she asked me to come urgently. I was there in 20 minutes. My boyfriend wasn't breathing anymore. He was sitting on the bed, pressed against the wall opposite the window. His face was pale, snow white. That thing took what it wanted, because I gave it permission. Now I know how expensive just one phrase can be. Don't say things you might regret. It's already the middle of the night. I'm sitting in the bathroom with the door closed and I can't go outside. There is something waiting for me in the hallway by the door that looks like my dog. But it doesn't seem to be my lovely pet after all. It hisses, howls in the womb, and begins to grin when trying to open the door. It seems that his fangs have become longer and sharper. Even the color of the eyes seems to have changed. They used to be golden, but now they have become cloudy, gray, and there is a bad light in the depths. Over the past few days, the dog has become completely exhausted. He refuses to eat. Wool climbs and clumps. I can't even take him to the vet. He doesn't come into my hands. I'm afraid to even walk past him. I'm afraid to leave the bathroom because he's sitting outside the door in the hallway. It all started a few days ago. During a walk, Danny broke off the leash and disappeared for 2 days. This has never happened before, and he was no longer young. Lately, he didn't like to go out. I've been looking for him around in the evenings, but he was nowhere to be found. He came back by himself. He was sitting and waiting at the door when he was allowed into the house. I let it go. I gave the food and went to work. And in the evening I found out that my mother was taken to the hospital with a fracture. The dog seized the moment, rushed at her feet, she fell and broke her arm. It was lucky that everything turned out that way, because there was a heavy table nearby. If she had hit his corner, it could have ended worse. Now I'm sure Danny had just such a plan. At first I thought I was crazy, but now I don't think so anymore. I returned from the hospital by nightfall. My dog was hiding somewhere in the house. Dad said he couldn't find him. I found him under a chair in the dark corner of the living room. I stretched out my hand to stroke him and got a deep scratch from his teeth. He had never hurt anyone before. That was the first time I thought he had changed. I left him under the chair, I didn't touch him. Dad was next. At night, Danny sneaked into parents' bedroom, jumped on the table and brushed off a heavy vase that was on the shelf above the bed with his tail. He was still sitting on that shelf while I called an ambulance. The father was alive, but unconscious. Danny looked pleased. I didn't see him in the morning, but I found that my bag was torn to shreds. And in the living room there is a real chaos. One curtain has been torn off. The armchair is scratched. My mother's vase, which was on the shelf in the sideboard, was thrown on the floor and broken. After work, I had to visit both mom and dad. My father came to his senses and asked me not to go home at night while it was there. He said that first Danny came to his bed, lay down on his chest and strangled him with his weight. And he waits a lot. And when dad tried to drive him away, he growled and grinned. My father threw him on the floor, kicked him out of the room and tightly closed the door to the bedroom. But Danny was able to get inside, climbed on the shelf and dropped a vase from it. Dad was sure he did it on purpose. I called my father down and went home anyway. There was no dog in sight. And at night, I woke up to the fact that he was strangling me. He lay down in my chest so that the wool was stuffed into my mouth and nose. How he stank. My dog never smelled like that. I jumped up, ignoring his growling and howling, jumped out of the room, ran into the bathroom. No sooner had I closed the door than Danny hit it with all his weight. He was catching up with me. It's still night. I'm locked in the bathroom and I can't go outside. There is something sitting behind the door that looks like my favorite dog. I'm afraid it will tear me apart if I open the door. We have been driving since early morning. Lunchtime came and went. Dusk was creeping on the road. It was high time to find some roadside cafe and have a snack. Or better, a hotel so as not to spend the night in the car. But the places were remote. The highway wound through fields and forests, and there was no hint of civilization. Even the radio didn't catch it. I noticed a sign on the side of the road from afar. Old wood, 2 kilometers. Look, there must be someone living there. Let's stop by. Maybe they have a store. And we turned off. The road deteriorated at once. The asphalt ran out and the priming with potholes began. When we crawled to Oldwood, our mood also deteriorated. One street along which there are old faded houses. Windows without glass, roofs with holes. Not a soul around. We stopped in the middle of the street. It was getting dark fast, but not a single light was burning. How far is it to the nearest town? I have no idea, the husband replied. There is no network, the navigator doesn't see satellites. We have been driving at random for 3 hours. And what are we going to do? We can go further. The road leads somewhere, doesn't it? Or we can spend the night here. We are unlikely to disturb anyone. We had been on the road for almost 14 hours, and I didn't want to go back to the car. And I offered to stay, especially since we have sleeping bags with us, and we only need a roof over our heads. Well, choose a house for the night, my husband said. There wasn't much to choose from. All the houses looked equally abandoned. I pointed at the nearest one. We moved things out of the trunk, took with us the remains of sandwiches and tea, had a quick snack, and went to bed. After a couple of hours, I was pulled out of sleep by anxiety. I had a sticky nightmare. I was running from something in the dark, stumbling, not seeing the road, and I couldn't run away. I sat up and heard footsteps behind the wall. A shadow flashed in one window, then in the next. I woke my husband up quietly. Someone is walking around the house. Someone seemed to hear me and froze without making a sound. The husband listened for a couple of minutes and began to say irritably, "There is no one there." And then from the window, from the street came a nasty giggle. And the footsteps rustled back, from one window to another, from the corner to the porch. I froze. "Did you lock the door?" "Yes, there was a castle there," the husband whispered. He threw back his sleeping bag and began to dress by touch. The light of the moon almost didn't get into the windows. I reached for my jeans too, and then the door banged. Yes, so much so that it rattled in the frame and something fell down in the walls. And then that nasty giggle again. "Who's there?" the husband asked loudly. "Go out and find out," the voice was affectionate. "What are you scared? Come out, I won't do anything to you." I gripped my husband by the hand, shook my head, but he himself didn't think to approach the door. "Invite us inside, we'll get acquainted under the roof." From this voice the skin turned cold. A frosty horror crept through. "You can't get out of the house. You can't get to the car either." "What should we do?" I asked in a whisper. "What? Your idea to come here. You decided to stay here. So think about what to do." My husband hisses back at me with unexpected anger. "So it's her, right? She's to blame for everything," came from behind the door. I felt creepy. "Nick, what are you doing? Let's tell me everything later, okay? Now we need to get rid of what is waiting outside the door." "It's you we need to get rid of," came from the street. "Come out. Or open the door, we'll come in ourselves." Despite the fear and panic, I suddenly felt that I wanted to do so. Open the door, go outside, and come what may. I was already walking to the exit when my husband grabbed my hand. "Don't open it." And immediately outside. "Well, how can you not open the door to the owners? This is our place. Once you looked in on us, you should get acquainted." And I saw my husband turning and heading for the door. Now I have stopped him. "Nick, listen to me. It can only talk to one of us. It doesn't seem to be able to enter by itself. Only if you or I let it in. It is necessary not to listen to it by any means." "You are talking nonsense," the voice came from behind the door again. "Go outside, honey. Open the door." Nick caught me at the door, dragged me to our sleeping bags and backpacks, turned out my bag. "Do you have earplugs with you? Or at least something that can be inserted into the ears as earplugs, so as not to hear." I miraculously had earplugs, just 2 pairs. I quickly found them among the little things from the bag, inserted them into my ears, remaining in complete silence. And then I noticed that Nick wasn't there, he was already at the door. I rushed to him, dragged him back to the sleeping bags, handed him earplugs. He nodded, put them in his ears and sat down next to me. This night was endless. We didn't hear any more persuasions, but we felt the door shudder under the blows, saw shadows rushing outside the windows. Everything stopped only with the first rays of dawn. We looked around the street from the windows, carefully took out the earplugs and heard only the singing of birds. We quickly packed up our things and jumped out of the house and drove away from this creepy place. I earn by repairing and finishing of houses. Yes, many people say that this is not a woman's business, but my father taught me this from an early age. I usually work alone. It is easier for me that way. This time the guy turned. He had to put his parents' old house in order. We discussed everything, bought materials, and I went to work. I must say the house was far from the nearest city, about 30 kilometers. And in order not to wander once again, I decided to spend the night right there on the first day. Moreover, it's summer, the weather is warm, the air is fresh. Staying there seemed like a good idea to me. Until about 10 o'clock in the evening, I was busy removing old wallpaper. I had a quick dinner and settled down on the sofa with a book. At 11, when I was almost asleep, there was a knock on the door. The knocking was so strong that the windows rattled. I felt uneasy. It's hardly possible to expect good from the night guests. Then the knocking was repeated, even stronger, even louder. This knock scared me a lot. I went to the door and asked, "Who's there?" And in response, there was another knock, as if there was a guy in behind the door. It even shook. And incomprehensible muttering. My courage ended there. I looked around. I realized that my guest would easily get inside the house through the windows. I really wanted to escape from there. But where will you go in the middle of the night when something is waiting for you at the open door? It was good that the house had an attic, and the exit to it was directly from the room. I went up there, pulled the ladder behind me, and a couple of minutes later I heard a noise downstairs. He was already inside. For about 3 hours he rattled, stamped. All 3 hours I heard the same obviously malicious muttering. When everything was quiet below, it brightened up in the street. I quietly made my way to the window and saw that the creature was walking away from the house, along the path to the forest. It looks like a man, but he had two long arms, a huge head. He was incredibly tall and moved in leaps and bounds. One glance was enough for me to hide in a corner and sit in it until the sun rose completely. Slowly and carefully, I went down from the attic. The room downstairs was trashed. The door is wide open, hanging on one hinge. I made coffee and went out on the porch. On one neighboring plot, an elderly woman was already digging in the flowers. I asked her if she had heard anything strange at night. The woman looked at me over, noticed the door hanging askew, and told me to wait a couple of minutes. She went to her house and soon returned with a large bag of salt. She said to scatter around the house. Of course, I started questioning her. She told a strange story. These houses were built on the site of an old forest. Many trees have been cut down, but most of the forest is still intact and comes close to the houses. And there are rumors that there are strange creatures in the forest, and there is only one remedy for them – salt. When I called my customer, he wasn't surprised at all. He said not to worry. He would bring more salt in the evening. I decided to finish the job and it never happened again. But I still didn't go outside after dark. I was born and raised in this house. I have always lived here, first with my parents, then alone. It's the only one I consider my home, and I have always been comfortable here, until the moment when he appeared, the night man. It started a few weeks ago. At first, I heard extraneous sounds in the evenings, footsteps, rustles. After a few weeks, I began to distinguish the voice, male, bass. It sounded like through the wall, and I reassured myself that these were new neighbors. In a sense, it was. The first time I saw him in the reflection of the mirror, a dark male figure was standing in the room behind me next to the window. I froze. He didn't move either. Then he disappeared. But there were sounds. The whole apartment creaked, rumbled, footsteps were heard everywhere. He calmed down only at night, and I couldn't sleep for a long time. Wandered around the house, looked into the corners. A few more times I noticed him in the mirrors, and one evening I came face to face. I went out to the kitchen in the evening and saw him, a dark, cloudy silhouette moving from the table to the window. I flew out into the hallway ran to the bedroom and slammed the door behind me. I sat on the bed almost until morning, watching the light turn on by itself in the hallway, listening to the wooden floor creak. Little by little I started to get used to it. The nightman appeared only in the evenings. He made noise, creaked. Sometimes I saw him. He still scared me. And often I was holed up in the bedroom or even in the pantry. But the last time there was a whole party in my apartment. Almost until morning, furniture creaked, voices were heard, everything rumbled and made noise. Around 4 in the morning I couldn't stand it. I ran out of the pantry, started throwing chairs and books into the murky shadows, turned on the lights everywhere, opened the windows. The shadows flickered, and then everything quietly subsided. I didn't hear them for the next week, and today my nightman appeared after lunch. There was a priest with him. He splashed around the corners, muttered, and at the end told me to leave.